Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Vampire Hunter D, Volume 6, Pilgrimage of the Sacred and the Profane, by Hideyuki Kikuchi and Yoshitaka Amano. Translated by Kevin Leahy. Narrated by Scott McCormick, with a full cast.
Prologue. Some called this town the journey's end. Others, its beginning. Mighty gales blew across the sea of golden sand that stretched from its southern edge. When those mighty winds hit the great gates of steel, pebbles as big as the tip of a child's finger struck them high and low, making the most plaintive sounds. It was like a heart-rending song sung by someone on the far side of those sands to keep a traveler there. When the winds were particularly strong, fine sand drifted down on the streets in a drizzle, amplifying the dry creaking of things like the wooden sidewalks and window frames at the saloon. And on very rare occasions, little bugs were mixed in with the sand, armed with jaws that were tougher than titanium alloy and stronger than a vise. The bugs could chew their way through doors of wood and plastic as if they were paper. Luckily, the petals of faint pink that always came on the heels of the insect invasion killed the bugs on contact, an event that imbued the whole encounter with a kind of elegance. As the order and timing of the arrival of these two forces never varied, the homes in town had to weather the ravages of the tiny killers for only 3 short minutes. And yet, on those rare nights when there were great numbers of the bugs, the town was enveloped by a harsh but beautiful hum, like someone strumming on their collective heartstrings. The sound of the bug's jaws did no harm to humans, and before long, the scene would be touched with the flavor of a dream, and then vanish as surely as any dream would on awakening. Some considered it a song of farewell, or even a funeral dirge, and people in town grew laconic as the fires in their hearths were reflected in their eyes. No one knew where the pale pink petals came from, while more than a few had headed off into the desert that was burning hot even by night. Not a single traveler had ever returned. Perhaps they'd reached their destinations, or perhaps their bodies had been buried by the sands, but no word ever came from them. There were some people in town who'd happened to meet such travelers. However, they'd only occasionally be able to raise some fragment memory of a vaguely remembered face, and then turn their gaze to the gritty winds that ran along the edge of town. This particular day, the song of the bugs was much sharper than usual, and the faint pink rain seemed a bit late, so the townspeople looked out at the streets in the afterglow of sunset with a certain foreboding. The funeral dirge faded as the time had come for those performing it to die. And that's when it happened. That's when the young man came to town. The men encamped around the tables and seated at the bar turned their fierce gazes toward the door. Grains of sand became a length of silk that blew in and then almost instantly broke apart to trace wind-wrought swirls on the floor. Eyes swimming with indecision caught the new arrival. Was this someone they could take in, or should the newcomer be kept out? It took a little while before the floorboards began to creak. Time needed to decide which direction to creak off in. Done. Behind the bar, the bartender had gone stiff with a bottle of booze in one hand and a glass in the other. There was curiosity and fear about just what was going to happen next. A table to the left of the door and a bit toward the back was the newcomer's destination. Two figures were settled around it, one in black, the other in blue, wearing an ebony silk hat and a morning coat with a hem that looked like it reached his ankles. One evoked a mortician. The deep blue brimless cap and the shirt of the same color that covered the powerful frame of the other were undoubtedly crafted from the hide of the blue jackal, considered by many to be the most vicious beast on the frontier. Both men were slumped in their chairs with their heads hung low, as if they were sleeping. All the other tables around the pair were devoid of customers. It was as if they were being avoided, as if they were despised, as if they frightened people. Another odd thing, it wasn't a whiskey bottle and glass that sat on the table between them. Black liquid pooled in the bottom of their brass coffee cups, which still had swirls of white steam lovingly hovering over their rims. The men didn't lift their heads. Several seconds of silence settled. Then,
"We don't take kindly to folks with no manners, kid."
And immediately after the figure in blue had spoken,
"Your mistake, Clay,"
the other one remarked.
"Well, I'll be."
The first man's blue cap rose unexpectedly to reveal his eyes. Set in his steely face, they were even bluer than his attire. Though he called the person he heard walking over a kid, he was only about 20 years old himself. His face looked mean enough to kill a timid man with one glare, but he suddenly smiled innocently.
"They say you can disguise your face, but you can't do a thing about how old your steps are."
"Too bad, Sonny."
The newcomer's voice spilled from lips like dried out clay, as cracked and creased as the rest of her face. More than the countenance so wrinkled that age could no longer be determined, more than the silver hair tied back with a vermilion ribbon, it was the slight swell in the gold-fringed vest and blouse that gave away the sex of the speaker.
"I happen to hate being ignored. I don't care if you're the biggest thing ever to happen to the outer frontier. I still think you ought to show your elders the proper respect. Don't you agree?"
The rest of the customers remained as still as statues. Even so, an excited buzz filled the room. Suddenly,
"That old lady's looking to start a fight with Bingo and Clay Bulow."
"What do you want?"
"Well, tomorrow I'm heading across the desert to the inner frontier. And I want the two of you to come with me."
"Hey, bro, some old hag I don't even know says she wants us to keep her company on a trip through the desert."
"There'd be a heap of pay in it for you. I'd like you to watch out for me and another person, you see. With you two along, I figure we'd get there in less than a week, and alive to boot."
"Bro,
you don't know what you say. Little brother, you'd best jiggle that memory of yours a bit. We might not have met her, but we know her name. You'll have to pardon me, but I'm asleep at the moment. Wish I could greet you properly, Granny Viper People Finder."
She was Granny Viper. The chances that the inner frontier's greatest locator of those who'd been hidden would run into the outer frontier's greatest fighters had to be about 10 million to one. They were really in luck.
"I couldn't care less about greetings. So how about it? What's your answer?"
"We're waiting for someone."
"Whoever it is, I'm sure they'll be dead before they get here."
The crone's mouth twisted into an evil hole. Her maw was a black pit without a single tooth in it.
"If they do make it here, they're going to have a little run-in with you, I suppose. Either way, it's the same thing, am I right?"
"Without a doubt." "But this time, we've got a real job cut out for ourselves. Depending on how things go, we might end up..."
Staring at the back of the hand that appeared before him without warning, Clay caught himself.
"I know, bro. I've said too much already."
Bingo's right hand slowly retracted.
"Sure you're not interested?"
The man in the silk hat didn't answer.
"Sorry, but I just have to have you two along."
The wall of men and women around the trio receded anxiously, and all eyes focused on the hands of the old woman and the two brothers. In light of what was about to happen, It was a completely natural thing to do. Their gazes were filled with consternation. Even an old woman like Granny Viper had to have some sort of weapon if she lived out on the frontier. Her lower back looked like it'd snap in two if someone even touched it. And just below it, she wore a survival belt with a number of pouches on it. Still, she had no bowie knife or machete, the most basic of equipment. But what everyone's eyes were drawn to was a large jar that looked like it was ceramic. It had an opening that seemed wide enough to easily accommodate the fist of a giant man, but it was stoppered with a polymer fiber lid. And although it looked like it would be fairly heavy, even if it were empty, the old woman walked and stood as if unconcerned with its weight. One of the taller spectators had been up on the tips of his toes for a while, trying to get a good look at it, but the lid was the same gray color as the jar, and its contents were completely hidden from view. Similarly, the weapons of the two men were every bit as eccentric as hers. What hung at the right hip of the younger brother, Clay, couldn't have been any more inappropriate for him. A golden harp strung with silver strings. As for the older brother, Bingo, what he carried was more surprising than anything. He was completely unarmed. Granny Viper, People Finder, and the fighting Bullow brothers, getting a sense that an otherworldly conflict never meant for human eyes was about to be joined here between some of the frontier's most renowned talents and the weird weapons they possessed. The saloon patrons were all seized by the silence of the grave. The crone's right hand slowly dropped to her jar. At the same time, Clay's hand reached for the harp on his hip. Bingo didn't budge an inch, and just as the three deadly threads were about to silently twist together, the wrinkled face of the crone looked back over her shoulder. The gaze of the youth in blue was there just a second later at the door. Closed since the crone entered, the door now had the eyes of all three of these rough customers trained on it. The door became an expanding domain of darkness on the wall. Perhaps the figure it revealed had been born of the very night itself. The saloon patrons backed away, and the hue of the black garments that covered all but his pale and perfect countenance made it seem that he blew in like a fog of fine sand. As if the countless eyes on him meant nothing, the young man shut the door behind him and headed over to the bar. What they were dealing with now was something even more unusual than the Bullow brothers or Granny Viper People Finder. With every step forward the figure in black took, grains of sand dropped from his long coat. To the women in the bar, even those seemed to sparkle darkly. The young man stopped at the bar.
There's supposed to be someone here by the name of Thornton.
Swallowing hard, the bartender nodded. Though he was big enough to serve as the bouncer, too, the man's colossal frame grew stiff.
You're Mr. D, aren't you?
No reply was needed, though the bartender had only heard one characteristic of the hunter. He knew this was unquestionably the man who stood before him.
He's out back right now.
The bartender raised his right hand to point the way.
But he's having himself a little entertainment at the moment.
It was common knowledge that in many cases, frontier town saloons also doubled as whorehouses. Dee walked off in the direction the man had indicated.
It's a pleasure to meet you. Bingo Bulow's the name. That's my younger brother, Clay. You might have heard of us. I was thinking we might get to know the greatest vampire hunter on the frontier.
Bingo looked at the back of the figure who'd halted his step. Like his body, the elder Bulow's face was extremely thin, and his chin was covered by a wild growth of beard. Seemingly hewn from rock, his expression shifted just a bit then. As if he'd merely stopped there on a whim, Dee started walking again.
Well, shut my mouth! This is a surprise! I didn't know there was a man alive who'd turn his back on Bingo Bullow when he offers an invite. I like your style. Indeed I do.
Hold it, you.
Clay jumped to his feet. His cruel young face grew red as hot blood rushed to his head. As he reached for his elegant weapon with his right hand, another thinner hand, that of his brother, pressed against his stomach, stopping him.
Knock it off.
The older brother's words must have been law, because the younger Bullow didn't utter a single complaint after that, and the anger that radiated from his powerful form rapidly dispersed.
I'll be waking up soon. We'll have to wait until the next time I'm asleep to pay our respects.
Out of the countless eyes there, only those of the crone sparkled. The door to the back room opened and then closed again. Swallowing the darkness given human form in the process, the cramped room was filled with a lascivious aroma. Long, thin streams of smoke rose from an opening in the metallic urn that sat on the round table. It was an aphrodisiac unique to the frontier sectors, and all who smelled the scent, young or old, male or female, were transformed into lust-crazed beasts. On the other side of the table sat an ostentatious bed that had been slathered with the gaudiest color of paint imaginable. And on that bed, something terribly alluring wriggled. A knot of naked women, all of them dripping with sweat. It was probably the influence of the aphrodisiac that kept them from so much as turning to look at the intruder as he entered. Perhaps wondering what was going on inside the intertwined flesh, a raven-haired head popped out of the middle of that pale pile of femininity, even as feverish panting continued to fill the air. From the man's face, it was impossible to tell whether he was young or middle-aged. Roughly pushing his way free of the women clinging to him, he finally stopped what he was doing and stared directly at Dee.
Well, I'll be. Just goes to show you, can't believe everything you hear, I guess. Your looks are so good, my hair's practically standing on end.
He hastily began shoving the women out of the way.
Come on, move it.
Although his squat form looked to be less than 5 feet tall, he had a considerable amount of fat on him, evidence of days spent in pursuit of culinary delights. He didn't bother to cover himself as he slipped on his underpants. Once the man was wrapped in a robe, he actually looked quite dignified. Digging a thick pair of glasses out of his coat pocket, he put them on. He almost looked like he could pass for a scholar from the capital.
This isn't exactly the most appropriate place to receive a guest who's traveled so far, but you see, I wasn't expecting to see you so soon.
He glanced at the electronic clock on the wall.
Actually, you're right on time. But back at the hotel, I heard that a cloud of moving miasma had shown up on the road and that no one would be able to get through for a couple of days. Guess I should have remembered I was dealing with the vampire Hunter D.
And what was surely a rare occurrence for the young hunter, he received a somewhat sheepish smile from the other man. But when the man in black failed to move even a single muscle in his face...
Well, I suppose I should tell you about the job then.
The reason he averted his gaze at this point wasn't so much to change the tone of the conversation, but rather because he'd reached the point where he could no longer stand looking at Dee head-on. Regardless of gender, those who gazed at the young man's gorgeous visage for too long began to hallucinate that they were being drawn into the depths of his eyes. Actually, the women that Thornton had shoved out of the way had been ready to voice their dissatisfaction when Dee suddenly entered their field of view and left them frozen with their mouths agape.
Okay, get your asses out of here. I'll pay you twice what you had coming.
The little man, Thornton, shoved them out. But the women kept their dumbstruck gazes trained on Dee until the very end.
Care for a drink?
Thornton picked up the bottle of liquor sitting on the table. But then he shrugged his shoulders.
Oh, that's right. You vampires like to say, I never drink wine. Don't you? Yeah. Well, sorry. I may be a lawyer, but I'm just a plain old human. Pardon me while I have one.
Thornton pressed the glass filled with amber liquid to his lips. Time and again, his Adam's apple bobbed up and down. He nervously brought his hand up to wipe his lips.
I wrote you for one purpose and one purpose alone. I want you to cross the desert, to go all the way to the town of Barnabas, across this desert of no return, where so many have never been seen again.
For what purpose? In your letter, you said you could furnish me with information about someone I have a great interest in.
That's correct. And the reason I can do so is because the request to send you out into the desert comes from that very person.
Now that it was late at night, the sound of the bugs had only increased in its plaintive rhapsody. A few minutes later, blossoms covered the town and the sounds died out and began anew, and then vanished again, as if the night would never end and the song of parting would never cease. It was at that moment that a wrinkled hand knocked on the door to the room in a hotel on the edge of town. There was no answer. Without waiting very long, the hand pushed against the door. The interior was claimed by the same shade of darkness as the world outside. The reason Granny Viper turned to the right side without hesitation wasn't because she'd memorized the location of the bed, but because she could see as well in the dark as she could at midday.
Pardon the intrusion.
Although she received no reply to her greeting, she could see the tall figure that lay on the bed clearly enough.
Ordinarily, I'd call you careless. But for the vampire hunter D, having the door locked or unlocked probably makes no difference. Anyone who came in here with evil in mind wouldn't live to tell about it. Sure, I'd heard of you before, but I never could have imagined you'd be so incredible. Obviously, you're awful good-looking, too. But what I couldn't believe was that someone actually ignored the Bullow brothers. That's when I thought to myself, that settles it. At first, I was aiming to ask the two of them to help, but forget that now. Who needs a couple of punks fresh out of short pants anyway? I've decided to go with you instead.
Here, the old woman paused and waited for the hunter to respond. But there was no reply. Perhaps he was just a shadow that had taken human form. She strained her ears, and still, she couldn't hear him draw a single breath. Nor could she catch the beating of his heart. The crone realized that if her night vision wasn't so keen, she'd never have noticed his presence.
When I first came in, I didn't feel the urge to kill from you. And I don't now, either. I've been to other hunters' rooms, but it's unbelievable. They're always on edge, never knowing when somebody's gonna try and get the drop on them, and you can feel the violence just hanging around in the air outside their rooms. No matter how big they are, you're above them all. If someone came in here, they'd take you for a stone until the second you struck them dead. On the other hand, if you wanted to, you could stop a foe cold through a stone wall with just a harsh look in their direction. But I suppose I'd be surprised if you had a mind to do that even once in your life. And that's why I've pinned all my hopes on you.
What do you want with me?
I already told you, didn't I? I want you to come with me. You know, across the desert to the town of Barnabas. There'd be a nice piece of change in it for you. Enough for all the booze and broads you'd ever want. I just know you couldn't say no to a sweet deal like this.
No.
Well, why the hell not?
Leave.
Stop mucking around. I just told you how set I am on having you. Maybe you think you're too good to listen to some old bag, eh? Well, I'll show you. You might not think so, but I'm pretty well known across the frontier. And while they may not be quite as dangerous as you, I know a lot of people, folks that'll come running just as soon as I give the word. No matter how tough you are, up against 100 of them.
As if pushed by something, her stooped figure leapt back, perhaps unable to weather the otherworldly air that staggered the imagination. She flew out of the room with terrific speed. Light flowed in from the corridor.
Stop it! What, do you plan on killing me? I'm more than 100 years old, you know. What'll you do if you give me a heart attack or something?
Yet the unearthly air continued to creep toward her.
Just stop it, or this kid, this girl, will die too.
Slipping around the door and reappearing in the rectangular space, pushing another figure. Someone with eyes that could pierce the darkness would see the shoulder-length black hair and the soft lines beneath the simple flesh-toned dress, and might even determine that the girl was about 17 or 18 years old. Without saying a single word, she just squatted there, hugging her own shoulders. The hunter's ghastly aura was merciless.
Please stop. The girl's name is Tay. She was one of the hidden. What's more, it was the nobility that hit her.
The girl's rigid body collapsed unexpectedly. She braced one hand against the floor. Rather attractive in its own way, her face was as expressionless as stone now, as if it terrified her to draw even the smallest of breaths. The girl seemed to have the world crushing in on her from all sides. Granny's face peeked around from behind the door as her expression turned deadly serious. She came out slowly, moving with a weighty and plaintive gait. Circling around from behind Tay, she put her hands on the girl's pale shoulders. She turned her gaze to the darkened depths of the room.
You know what my trade is? I'm a people finder. I've been nicknamed Viper, like the snake. But I'm not one of them dollar a dozen orphan trackers they've got hanging around here. I specialize in children who've been taken. I find the hidden, you know? I can't very well stand out here talking about it. Let me come back in for a second. Come on, stand up, child.
Viper forced Tay to her feet and went back into the room.
Have a seat.
Tay settled herself in another chair in a display that took presumptuousness to laudable heights. And yet the reason she didn't complain about Dee's rudeness as he continued to just lie there was because his ghastly aura still permeated her flesh.
This girl...
You mentioned the nobility, didn't you?
Why, yes, I do believe I did. She's a genuine, bona fide victim of hiding by the nobility. I nearly killed myself getting her out of Castle Gradinia.
For all the supernatural phenomena that occurred out on the frontier, the notion of the hidden had an especially chilling connotation. Unlike profit-motivated kidnappings, these could suddenly happen right out in public, or under conditions where it should have been impossible to just vanish. The victim could be young or old, male or female, but in the case of young ladies, it was almost certain to conjure images of a dreaded fate that would make anyone quake with terror. Even as it robbed them of their fears, there were several possible causes for these disappearances, and they were sometimes attributed to unknown creatures, or to the dimensional rips that appeared at irregular intervals. But in cases where members of the nobility were suggested as the culprits, the terror sprang not from the disappearance itself, but from the anticipated result. What kind of fate might befall a young lady in such a situation? If they were merely prey to satisfy their captor's taste for blood, they might be saved. Luckier still were those who were given positions as maidservants on the whim of the nobility, though this was less common. A fair number of girls were rescued under these circumstances, but there could be more to it than that.
A hell of a time I had there. I was thinking I'd taken out all their defensive systems, but there was still one left. Damn thing put me to sleep until night. Well, I'd already made up my mind about what I was going to do, so I drove a stake through the bastard's heart just as he was getting out of his coffin. Still, he was thrashing around like nobody's business, and I had to keep that accursed stake stuck in him for a good 3 hours before he simmered down. After that, I searched the place and happened to find this girl. Not to worry, though. I've checked her out, and as far as I can tell, there's nothing wrong with her. I had her hypnotized so deeply, it would have driven her mad to go any further. And naturally, she can walk around in daylight.
How did you find her?
There really wasn't much to it. Once I went down into the basement, I found a prison where they kept humans. She was locked in there. I asked her a few things, and by the sound of it, they had her slaving away as a maid of sorts. You can guess the rest. She was still right in the head, so she remembered which village she hails from. The sheriff in Gradinia even had a request from her parents to look for her. And that's how I ended up transporting her. That's what I do, you know.
And the noble, what was his name?
The old woman didn't answer that question. Although the hunter's tone and the direction he faced hadn't changed, the crone understood that this query was directed at Tay. Tay's body trembled, but her face remained aimed at the floor. She didn't say a word. It was almost as if she were erecting shields of incredible density all around herself.
What are you doing? Hurry up and answer the man. This could mean the difference between us getting to the town of Barnabas safely or not.
Tay said nothing.
Oh, you stupid little twit.
Granny raised her right hand violently while keeping her back as straight as an arrow. Apparently, her hunching had been part of the act to get their sympathy, but there was no need for her to follow through with the blow.
Leave.
Wait, just one second. I'm not done speaking my piece yet.
There wasn't an iota of the bluster she'd shown the Bullow brothers left in her voice. The sudden and complete reversal was a nice change, though.
Like I just explained, we're in a situation where we've got to get across the desert, and we've got a time limit, too. If we don't make it in 4 days, counting tomorrow, we're out of luck. See, the girl's family is in the town of Barnabas, but the morning of the 5th day, they'll be moving on to somewhere else. Given the size of the desert, it's going to be a close call. If we were to go around it, it'd take us more than a week, which is why we definitely need us some heavy-duty backup. Now, I don't know just what brings you to town, but if you haven't taken care of whatever it is, I'd like you to put it off for a while and come along with us. I don't care whether you want to do it or not. I've already settled on you. Hell, even the girl said she likes you. Didn't you, sweetie?
The crone sought out some corroboration, but the girl remained as stiff as a board.
See what I mean? She likes you so much that she's at a loss for words. Of course, that's only natural, you being so handsome and all. This may sound strange, but if I was a tad younger myself, I don't think I could keep away from you, stud.
Of course, Dee didn't move a muscle. Seeing that this was having no effect, Granny changed tactics.
Have you no pity for this poor child? She was only 10 when she was taken, and she spent 8 years locked up in a noble's castle. Even I don't know what happened to her during all that time, and I'm not about to ask. Can you blame me? Somehow, though, the girl survived. That's right. She kept herself alive for 8 long years. A girl all alone in a world we can scarcely imagine. Doesn't she have the right to live the rest of her life in happiness now? When I found out her family was still alive and well, it brought tears to my eyes. I tell you, her life's just about to begin. Now, wouldn't you want to do everything in your power to help her out?
Winded from her speech, Granny caught her breath. Tears glistened in her eyes. It was all terribly impressive. Dee's answer was brief.
Leave.
Okay. I get the message. I'm gonna call it a night. But there's no way I'm giving up on this. We need you. I don't care what I gotta stoop to. I'm gonna get you to come along with us. Come on, Tay.
She indignantly turned to the door, her back suddenly hunched over again. Taking the girl with downcast eyes by the hand, Granny dragged her out into the hall and disappeared. The door's reverberations were absorbed then by the air and building materials, and mere seconds later, when silence once again ruled the darkness, the chirping began. It was the small and distant sound of the bugs pecking at the dark of the night, scratching at the hearts of all who listened. It was the sort of sound that those who heard it want to lie down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.